right on my wavelength, because, you know, look, we are the last developed country in the world that has no national paid leave for parenting for illness. And what we know from the few states that have done, in California being the most notable here, is it builds loyalty. You know, if you really analyze turnover in a lot of businesses where you have to retrain somebody, where you first have to find them, and then you have to retrain them, making your employees feel that you care about these milestones in their lives, and you give them the chance to have a child, adopt a child, recover from a serious illness, take care of a really sick parent, and get a period of time that's paid, just cements that relationship. So it is an issue that I feel strongly about on just personal terms. Yeah, I've written about this. I was a young lawyer, relatively, by our standards in Arkansas at the time, it was a medium, large firm of 12 lawyers, you know, nothing giant like we have today. And I got pregnant, and nobody said anything to me, I didn't say anything to them. We didn't know what to say to each other. And so I walked down the hall, going to the conference room, the library or something, and, you know, I would see one of the partners coming in and go, oh. And so we had no leave program, nothing. But when the time came, they said, well, what do you want? I said, well, you know, I've read the literature in 3 or 4 months, is what you need to really bond with your baby. And they said, well, okay, can we call you? I said, of course you can call me. But I think that you have really set a high standard now, you know, trying to figure out how to get there and how companies that might have more challenges live up to that is going to be the issue. But I think here at Capital City, Brendan, you provide paid vacation and paid sick leave, right?
Yep.
And you have a 401k.
All basic benefits. The thing that we're struggling with is health insurance. When we went to get the broker last year, he said they're going to increase 18%. 18%, that's more than 5 times inflation. Most of our employees are getting about a 3 or 4% wage increase. So you can't keep up with going up that high every year. You only get 3 or 4%. More and more of our resources are going into health insurance. It takes away from the ability to do other benefits. And we finally did some negotiation, got it down to 13%, which is still 4 or 5% inflation. And because of that, we had to raise the deductibles, we had to raise out-of-pocket maximums. I'm really concerned that going forward, we're not going to be able to, our employees will be able to afford it. We'll be able to just pay basic premiums because it's getting so out of hand.
Well, I'm concerned about that too. I mean, I think, you know, we have a lot of work to do to make sure that private employers like yourself who are buying through a broker and making your own contracts, right, for these benefits, don't suffer disadvantages in either pricing or benefits going forward. And we have to get to a level of analysis here that is really important because it would be interesting to find out why in Iowa a well-established company like yours is being asked to pay so much more for a private plan. And I've begun to do this analysis. I can't tell you what the results are, I'm just beginning it, but you know, in some of the states that adopted the Affordable Care Act exchanges and adopted the Medicaid expansion, which is, as you know, fully funded by the federal government, their percent increase for private employers is really low. And why is that? Because hospitals have other sources of revenue. Hospitals are getting paid for uncompensated care. So poor people show up, and instead of it being absorbed by the hospital, passed on to their insurer, which in turn passed it on to Capital City Crew, there's now another source of it. I'm not sure that's the only reason. I've got to, as I say, spend more time looking at this. But I am committed to trying to, you know, build on what works in the Affordable Care Act. 16 million people now have insurance who didn't have it. And when I was in Mount Vernon yesterday, a woman, local businesswoman, came up and she said, I don't know what I'm going to do. My 26-year-old son has been on my policy now, and you've been on your parents' policy?
I'm still under 26, but, you know, I haven't been able to be married. We're not on a family yet, but that difference in, you know, 26, it's like, five. And then as a small business owner, to hire a full-time employee and to pay those benefits, that has to be me, because I pay someone else, they have to be doing everything as well, because it is a big step for a full-time employee. And right now, I'm not in need of that besides myself. And my works, my staff, and the couple of people who work for me are great. They love doing what they do, and they do it wholeheartedly, and I'm really proud to say that we pay, you know, I pay my kids, because they are really our meeting. But, you know, we all work together, and I know that they're going through, I know what I've gone through as working in high school, working in college, you know, working in, you know, I have a lot of people who are supporting families that commit my business and that also work for me, and I see that, and that right there is my biggest worry, is if I'm not married, and my spouse doesn't have insurance or a job that, you know, we cannot work together at this business without something else with those benefits, because my business I would be afraid of what my business, how shaky it would become. You know, I'm really sick right now. That could really jump over a lot of things just in that healthcare.
It's a shame.